I started reading early in the week, and the first thing I read is, I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. And that sent me back to my childhood, where my father was a gardener. And that wasn't his livelihood, but he'd come off a farm, and he was going to be a gardener. He was going to have something planted. My mother liked roses, so our whole backyard, and it was a considerably sizable backyard, very small house, the big backyard, was plowed and furrowed and fertilized and made ready for roses. And we had probably 3 dozen beautiful rose bushes in there, and they were gorgeous. And they were, and I just loved looking at them and bringing them in the house, and that was just, it was just gorgeous. It was kind of, you know, like walking out of the house today and looking up at the trees. They were beautifully green, blooming. Everything is just gorgeous.
Covered with pollen.
Covered with pollen, making people sneeze. But look at the good side. At any rate, the war started, and the roses got dug up and replanted with the Victory Garden, which everybody was doing. My dad was in the service, but he was stationed at this Naval Air Station, so he didn't have to, he came and went every day. But we had the garden. And then something better than the roses came into my life, and that was carrots that you pulled out of the ground and rinsed in the hose and ate, and there's nothing better. I mean, they were just absolutely wonderful. Corn, peas, greens, a lot of things, and for the years of the war, we had that Victory Garden. And so when I said, I am the true vine and my Father is the gardener, I had to go relive all that over again. And it was beautiful, and it also reminded me of the way nature is a teacher for us. Now, Jesus was speaking to his disciples. These are called the final discourses, or the farewell discourses of Jesus in the book of John. Nobody writes better than John about the life of Jesus. I don't know who to start with first, but John was, as you remember, the fisherman, brother of James, sons of Zebedee. He was a loud, thunderous, boisterous man, and he met Jesus, and he really did become a scholar and a gentleman. He was the disciple that Jesus loved. He was the one that, on the cross, Jesus said, you know, son, behold your mother. He gave his mother into John's keeping. So they were the closest of friends, and he grew like he had been planted and grown into a marvelous poet and a philosopher, and no doubt, if you think fishermen in those days were illiterate and numbskull and didn't have, you know, any reading, you try to pick up the Revelation and just read the beginning of it. Or you look in the beginning of John and read the story that only he tells. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And he became flesh and dwelt among us, full of grace and truth. That's not the words of an illiterate fisherman by any means. But anyway, we start out with, I am the true vine and my Father is the gardener. Jesus very often used the textbook of nature to teach from. He didn't have an encyclopedia we've only got 3 sets left, but we had 6. Because every child had this was when Bunkin' Wagnalls was sold in the Winn-Dixie. You know, when you bought your groceries, you got a volume of the encyclopedia. I got a set for every one of them. And they all took them away with them, and their children are using them still. The yearbooks, they haven't kept up too well, but we've got lots of encyclopedias. There were no books in the days of John's writing. Very few things to write on. You had scrolls, papyrus to write on, but nobody had books in their home. Certainly didn't have any online information. Learning and teaching had to be an oral thing, but Jesus used the textbook of nature to teach. You know, all of his parables are, and their parabolic teaching means that you're taking something you can point to that people recognize and compare it to something they don't know about. And so here, John is using the parabolic, I am the true vine and my Father is the gardener. This is Jesus speaking. And of course, everybody can picture a vine. You kind of know what the vine can, runs along, it grabs onto things, it will go on, it will go wherever it can go. It will go without much soil, it will go without much moisture, but it goes to where it can find a source. And a vine is a wonderful thing. One of those questions that we asked long ago when, tell me why the stars do shine. Tell me why the ivy twines. Tell me why the ocean's blue, and I will tell you why I love you. A vine is really a good symbol of teaching, because the vine is my Father. I am the true vine. My Father is the gardener. So God is in charge of the vine. But when Jesus says, I'm the vine, I am what supports. Root, stem, and leaf are vegetable. Whatever grows off the root, stem, and leaf is fruit. So he says, I'm the true vine. My Father's the gardener. I've got all the nutrients I need to pass on to you, and I want you to be the fruit. I'm the, you know, you're the branches, and off of you is going to grow the fruit that feeds the world. Wow, that's what he's saying in this. And the disciples, I think, probably can picture the vine. They can picture the branches. They can picture the fruit on the vine. And vineyards are really a part of biblical history. Everything, I mean, that was a major source of income, major source of nutrition, major source of making, you know, the beverage was very much in demand because water supply was limited, and you know, the fruit of the vine was good nutrition and a good source of moisture, water for your good health. Lots of things. I still enjoy grapes very much, more than I do juice, but I like the grapes. It's called sugar in a bag, but it's good. It's good sugar. And so I understand the fruit of the vine very much. Again, the metaphor for fruit is that it is the fleshy part that grows off the branches. It has the seed in its own case, so that you eat the fruit, you spit out the seeds, and the next generation is on the way. It is self-perpetuating. So when Jesus is talking to the disciples about, he is the new source of nutrition, he's the vine, they're the branches, and they produce the fruit, and it perpetuates itself. It not only nourishes them, it nourishes everyone that picks it, everyone that gets hold of it is nourished by it, and they pass it on. It is endless, it is eternal, and that is a beautiful metaphor. I don't know how it could be taught any better than looking at the vine and the branches, but that's not the end of the story. He cuts off, my Father's the gardener, he cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes so that it will be even more fruitful. That's a lesson I learned watching my father, the gardener, not only, you know, pick and cull out strawberries or whatever to make the rest of the crop better, but all of the fruit trees were pruned. And we had satsumas and orange trees and, you know, lots of citrus in the backyard. And that also was, you know, wonderful fruit. Beautiful to pick, smell good, taste good, kumquats I can still eat whole, they're wonderful. spit out the seeds, and the next tree is in the ground. Just a, you know, wonderful teaching metaphor. Pruning is something that is, that the branches die, you cut them off. The branches aren't producing anything. They are good for nothing but firewood, but they are good for that. There's some kind of a devastating metaphor of casting the unfruitful branches in the fire, which is, you know, again, kind of a doom and gloom ending for them. But he says, every branch that does bear fruit gets pruned so that it will bear more. And that is a, you know, a good gardening property, that you have to cull the dead branches, you have to prune the ones that will produce more leaves and more fruit. I guess it was probably, Monday, Tuesday evening, I walked out either to get the garbage can or take it in, I don't know which one, but I realized that the cypress tree at the end of the driveway, which was about 3 feet tall when we moved in, is now 100 feet tall. It's way over the top of the house and into the pine tree. And it's got a bowl about like this now, and it was just a stick. But it's a cypress tree that was predicted not to live because it wasn't on the water. It was on the edge of the driveway. And somebody rode by our house one day and said, that tree's dead, and I'll be glad to take it out for you and take it away. And I said, well, you know, that's a cypress tree. It's deciduous. And he said, no, it's dead. I don't think he knew deciduous, but anyway, I said, no, you don't leave that tree alone, because it did not have a leaf on it last Monday night, but Wednesday morning it was full of green needles, bright, beautiful green, you know, the lime green that is only part of the first leaves of spring. The oak trees all had new leaves on them. Everything was just all at once had come to life again, and it was just beautiful. Nature is our best teacher. If the flowers, let's see, what is this, the poem that says, if flowers blossom, then so do we. If what looks dead is, you know, withered and sere and dry, and then just a touch of something that generates life comes alive in that, and it produces new life, new leaves. It's almost like being reborn, you know, almost like eternal life. It comes back. It looks dead and it comes back. I'm probably rambling a little bit, but it's there. I mean, this is the textbook that Jesus taught from, and it's very appealing to me. He cuts off every branch that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes so that it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you, but remain in me, and I also remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, and you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. And that's true. You cut off that branch and sit it by itself, and it's dead and gone. It will be good for nothing but firewood. But as long as it's tied to its strength and its source of life, it will not only grow and produce, it will be a beautiful sight and a blessing, because it does bear fruit that is good for the nourishment of everything around it. If you do not remain in me, you're like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up and burned in the fire. But if you remain in me and I in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. This is to my Father's glory that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples." That's kind of a beautiful lesson for the disciples to hear. As long as you are in me, you are going to be fruitful. You're going to have a calling. You're going to have success in your calling. And you are going to feed all those around you, all those you come in contact with one way or another. You know, fruit is food. The fruit of the Spirit is joy, love, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, great faithfulness, and self-control. And we've been through that lesson. But that is what you are generating. That is the fruit you produce, the fruit of the Spirit. That's part of the lesson. Then we skip over to a little bit later in that same, this is John 15. "As the Father has loved me," Jesus is telling them, right before his crucifixion, he wants to tell them everything he knows. He wants to teach them everything he can. I think I've told you this story, but my first day of teaching, I had been waiting to start. I was just so anxious to get going on it. I wanted to be a teacher, and I was ready to go, first day of school. But the first day of my first assignment, we had auditorium time and orientation. We walked the grounds, we found the lockers, we found the restrooms, we found the cafeteria, we did all that kind of stuff. This is John Gorey, junior high school, in the old days. That was the second day we had a convocation in the auditorium, and you met the band director and the football coach and the basketball coach and everybody for all the organizations. And then the rest of the day they signed up for what you wanted to do. And I think the third day we had some guests that we introduced the faculty. We introduced all the teachers, and you got to know who everybody was and where the principal's office was and where the nurse's station was and all that kind of stuff. Anyway, it got Friday, and I had been through 4 days of school and hadn't had a chance to teach anything. And I was really ready to go. Friday, the bell rang, and they came in and sat down, and here it was. And I think I've said this in jest, but I think I taught them everything I knew. And it was only 9:15. That was it was really fun. We did pass out books. It was a good day, but I taught them everything I knew because I wanted them just to know that I was so glad to be here. I did care about their education, and they were so bright and beautiful, and so I just wanted to go with it. When we left that day, when the bell rang and they left, one little guy, his name was Dale, I will never forget him. He had he'd been born with one arm, and he had a sleeve that was empty. Dale had asked me when we were passing out the books if he could help, and I said, "Sure?" And he said, "Yes." And he was so eager, I couldn't say no. And that little boy could do with one arm what, it would take three other kids to do. He could pick up the books, he could balance them, and he could get them passed out. And he was so delighted. He just was having the best time. And when he left, he walked up the door and he said, "Miss Magnat, I love your class." And that was my hook, I felt like I was doing what I was supposed to do, and it was great. Being a teacher is wonderful, and especially using whatever you have at hand. I had at hand a little bit in my head, but we did a lot of things that made it look like it was going to be a good year in that class, and it was. It was a wonderful year. Jesus could do that without any textbooks, without any internet, without anything, because he had the lilies of the field to point to, and you could say, consider the lilies of the field. And you had a lesson that you couldn't beat with a stick. I mean, it was a wonderful lesson. I'm the vine, you're the branches. That's another lesson you can't ignore. So he becomes a masterful teacher without a scroll, without a, by the way, probably the only written piece of literature in his life experience was the Torah. And Torahs were few and far between because they were handwritten. And usually there was one in the synagogue. Of course there was one in the temple in Jerusalem, but every synagogue probably had a Torah, and it stayed in an ark in a safe place. And that was the only, and actually only the boys, and only the boys 5 years and older were allowed to handle the Torah and learn to read it. And it was a long time before, I guess it was Mary and Martha days, when Mary and Martha kind of, they were, I think Jesus was championing for them because he insisted that they learn to read. Lazarus gave them reading lessons, and so they were well ahead of their time in the day. But anyway, the textbook of, and the experience of the disciples was wonderful and rich because Jesus pointed to nature and to the natural world, and he taught them everything they needed to know about living and loving in that natural setting. Now, he goes on to say, as the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Now, remain in my love. I'm a good, strong vine. You are good, strong branches. I will keep you nourished the way God keeps me nourished, and you will pass on this good fruit to the world you live in. If you keep my commandments, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My commandment is this: love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this: to lay down one's life for one's friends. I'm going to stretch that just a little bit. Jesus told his disciples, if you want to be a disciple of mine, if you love me, you will deny yourself and take up your cross and follow me. Self-denial, this was part of the call to prayer and self-denial for Methodist women, and I found a piece of literature that was so astonishing to use for that lesson, but it explained to me what self-denial is. It is not giving up the cherry on the top of your chocolate sundae. It's not, you know, forsaking ice cream in the evening or giving up Diet Cokes or whatever it is you like to do. That's not what self-denial is. He said, if you would follow me, you must deny yourself and take up your cross and follow me. Now, a cross is a cause. His cause was the salvation of humanity. He took up that cross for the salvation of those he loved, and that was everybody. And he said, you've got to take up a cause. That you don't deny yourself just for the fun of it, just for, you know, maybe being a little more healthy if you give up, something that you might not be good for you anyway. But if you deny yourself by taking up a cross, that is, adopting a cause of some kind, if you adopt a cause, then you can follow me. And that's a beautiful explanation of what Lent is all about. I don't think it really is about quitting something that's unhealthy for you. You ought to do that anyway, and you ought to do it all the time, not just for Lent. It's about taking up some positive cause that you can make a difference in. It's about being fruitful. It's about producing fruit. It's about feeding someone that needs nourishing, whether it's spiritual food or physical food. It's about making sure that you love somebody the way God has loved you. That's the whole story of Jesus talking here, is we're connected, and I want you to know that the reason you're connected is because you have to deny yourself, take up your cross, have a cause, and you do that cause through love. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I call you friends, because everything I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. And so whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. This is my commandment: love one another. Beautiful, beautiful sermon. And it's very few words, but I think you probably will remember that the greatest commandment that Jesus said, the whole law is based on this: love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And love your neighbor as yourself. The peace of the world, the peace of your own life, the peace of your day and night depend on that. And that is when Jesus came back to meet his disciples. He had given this commandment, you know, this is the main thing: love one another as I have loved you. This is, and in that way, your joy will be made complete. And I don't know that there is any real joy where there is not a great deal of love. And, you know, John, of course, is the one who is called the beloved, because he is, in spite of the fact that he was supposed to be so loud and boisterous as a fisherman, being a disciple of Jesus changed his heart and mind in such a way that he became probably the greatest theologian of biblical literature. And if you want to get into high theology, it is in the Gospel of John, which is very different than the other three, and it's in the Revelation, where he promotes the idea of God's justice. And that kind of brings me to another thing. Dick is reading the new book out called the Norse Mythology. And he was reading to me some parts of it. And I said, that's in the Bible. And he said, no, it's not. This is Greek. This is Norse mythology. I said, no, there's only one story. Different people tell it in different ways, but it's the same story. And he was so amazed that I got the Bible out, and he was reading something about the creation in the Norse mythology, and it was Adam and Eve, and it was in the Garden of Eden, and there was a flood. And I mean, I said, there's one story. It's just told in different ways. And those who know it best, those who know it best, know that the story is about God so loved the world. He sent his only begotten Son, whosoever believes in him might not perish, but have everlasting life. That's the story. And that's what everybody's looking for, is the love of God and the life of God in them, on the earth and beyond. And John tells that story probably as well as, if not better, than anybody ever did. We're coming to the... I said I didn't know where I was going to go with this, because I was very full. And I think that's a good place to go to. I think we got the gist of John's meeting. The student book had one thing in it that I wanted to call to your attention. If you don't read your student book, I want you to turn to page 19 when you get home, or read it and look at seeing the need, because it speaks to something very important in our Christian experience. We take an oath as when we join the Methodist Church, and if you remember, it used to be just prayers, presents, gifts, and services. You know how to pray. Present, you know how to be here. Gifts, you know how to give. Services, you know how to help one another. But the fifth one was added some years ago, and it snuck up on us. The fifth one is witness. You promise to be a part of this congregation and support it with your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your services, and your witness. And your witness need not be oral. It could be musical. It could be teaching. It could be smiling. It could be giving somebody a hug. It could be calling on someone who is not doing very well or who needs a friend. Your witness is to love one another as I have loved you. Jesus said, the Father has loved me. I've passed that love on to you. Now, nothing in the world is more important than you pass that love on day by day to anybody you meet. Amen.